specifically look at.
And he is
He works, he is part of Acton Media Group, is an executive editor, and has a bio that is well worth reading if you ever get a chance. But he told me, just say, this is Hector Hurd, and he does an excellent job, and I will turn this over to him. And again, thank you.
Before we go, with Councilman Orleans is here, wanted to introduce Councilman Orleans.
Okay, Jerry Owens, Councilman Orleans. Any others?
Mr. Gentleman, to tell today and say, hey, I voted for you three times.
I want to tell me, are you writing the stories next week?
I said, I'm getting the wrong guy. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we have drawn the straws, and we will begin from right to left. You have a 2-minute introduction. So we will begin with Sean Wright, and you also have the first question. And then we will start, the second question will be Lori Henry, then Marie, then Shelley, and then Shelley, then Marie, then Lori, then Sean, until we run out of time. Mr. Wright.
Well, good evening, everyone, and thank you to the Roswell Women's Club for hosting this great event. And thank you to Mr. Hurd for moderating, and also a big thanks to all of you who come out to be part of this process. And to the Roswell Women's Club, I appreciate you being trailblazers that are blazing a path for my daughter to someday walk through here in Roswell. But let me begin with who I am not. I am not a career politician, as many of you have already attested to. I am not one who participated in the Roswell political circles. I'm not even a person who is a single issue candidate. I'm not a traffic or density expert, as most of us are not. But let me tell you who I am. I am a husband, a father of five, four of them who live in Roswell, a grandfather with one who lives in Roswell, a lover of Jesus and great baseball, but not necessarily in that order. I'm a veteran of the First Persian Gulf War. I am a servant leader with an eye to the future. I pray that I'm a visionary who cares about my children's and grandchildren's future and yours also. I've been involved in the community here for many years through sports, with my kids at their schools, and also through church and volunteering. But it's time for leadership that is honorable, one who will serve the citizens of this great city, and also who will work to bring back a oneness that we need in this city and eliminate and reduce some of this divisive talk that we've been having. So I will just tell you this. It begins with vision. It begins with leadership. Where there is no vision, the people will perish. And we're at a crossroads right now in Roswell where we need vision that not only is for today, but it's for the next 50 years. Thank you.
Lori, you're back.
Thank you, Hector. My name is Lori Henry, and I would like to earn your support and your vote this evening. I moved to Roswell in 1974. I've been married for 30 years, raised my family here. And from 2001 to 2009, I served on the Roswell City Council. Some of my accomplishments are the big box ordinance, which restricted new big boxes for coming into Roswell. Also, the mixed use district that was ultimately adopted, that I co-authored, adopted by the state of Georgia as a model ordinance. Also, I championed the LCI initiative that brought in the streetscape improvements to Highway 9. No one on council at the time thought we'd ever get the $2.3 million, but we ultimately did it. Another thing that I fought very hard against was the Charlie Brown project, which was a huge, absolutely enormous project. It would have required a cement factory on site for 5 years. It had 12 to 27 story buildings. It would have brought the city to its knees. I don't care where you lived in Roswell, it would have brought the city to its knees. The transportation issues were astronomical. That's what brought me back. A couple of years ago, we adopted a zoning ordinance that is now allowing extremely high densities. When I was on council, we had an average density of 20 units or less per acre in rental. Now, we are talking about 100 units per acre, and we are not talking about infrastructure. We need to talk about infrastructure, whether it's water, whether it's transportation. We need to address all of those issues. And keeping in mind that we all moved to Roswell not for a urbanist environment. We moved here because of the wonderful historic district. Thank you.
Great.
Good evening. My name is Marie Wilsey, and I'm a candidate for Roswell City Council. I'd like to thank the Roswell Women's Club and Hatcher Burn and the City of Roswell and all of you for coming out tonight, and especially my husband Glenn and all of my friends who have supported me over the last few weeks. I've served the city as a volunteer over the last 6 years, serving our neighborhood as president of our homeowners association, serving on the planning commission, working very hard with the Roswell Arts Fund to bring the city's first sculpture tour, and coming to a lot of meetings, and I'm really looking forward to this as another opportunity to serve you. Roswell finds itself at a crossroads today with many opportunities, but also many challenges. We need to find a long-term plan that includes revitalization on our corridors while protecting the things that we love most. During this campaign and during my tenure on council, I would offer three promises. Number one is to keep high zoning out of our neighborhoods. In spite of what you may have heard, I will resolve to keep high zoning out of our neighborhoods. Over the past few years, few months, the council has done a lot of work to make sure that the codes are reworked to make so that they evolve to do that. And I stand firm that development should match and should be in context to its surrounding areas. One of my solutions is that there are very few undeveloped parcels left, so maybe we need to go back and take a look at those parcels and make sure that they shape, that they are zoned the way we would like to see them developed. My second priority is to improve the Holden Ridge corridor. We have beautiful neighborhoods and a wonderful downtown, but I think we can all agree that our front door needs some work, our main driveway. So I resolved to do everything I can to make sure that that corridor is revitalized. And again, thank you all for coming tonight. I look forward to answering the questions.
There's not a button in front of me. Unless it's that. There's not a button. Can you all hear me?
No.
Over here.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Shelby Sears, and everything that they said, I agree to a good extent. But I'm going to you in a little different light. I'm going to approach this as a business person and making business decisions. And I, like Sean, don't have all the answers, but I do know where to get the answers. And I know how to make good decisions for the people of Roswell. I have lived in Roswell since 85. And my children have grown up here, and I've been active in the community. One of the things that I tell people, before it was coon and sheep and divine, I was one of the five ladies that raised the $60,000 to put the gas lanterns and pavers down the street of the historic district. I am very vested in this town and this city. People say, who is she? Well, yes, I'm a realtor, but I am here to give back to my community. I don't want to be a politician. I want to be a leader in helping the city of Roswell grow and flourish. And we've got to think out of the box, and that's a cliche statement, but we have to think in the realm of what's going to happen 10 years from now, 20 years from now. We've got to think of these jumps now because somebody else is going to do it. And if we don't, the money is going to go elsewhere and then we will be sitting. Thank you.
Thank you. Now, as I said, the first question will be to Sean. I grew up in Texas, so we have a saying there, you know, some guys like the ranch and some just like to wear the hat. And we want to know what you're going to do besides wear the hat. What skills, what ideas do you bring to this job?
Well, Hatcher, I'm from Arkansas, and I enjoy battling with some Texans from time to time. There are several things that I would like to do. One of the biggest things that we need to look at is what is happening in East Roswell. And I'd like to get to a point to where it's a little E instead of a big E and a little W and whatever the case may be. Because at some point we got to figure out what it is that makes Roswell one Roswell. We've been talking a lot about it, but it doesn't seem like we're doing much about it. We're trying, but I don't know for sure if the people in East Roswell, as I go walking and knocking on their doors, agree with us. So whether we agree with the premise or not, of whether or not East Roswell is the quote-unquote stepchild, they believe that for the most part. And I've learned that in walking those neighborhoods. And so I say that instead of us just trying to force things down their throat, let's take a look at what we can do. One of the biggest things that we can do is take the city council, for instance. Right now, the city council is set up to be functionally, reporting functionally with different departments within the city. What I would propose is actually having one person represent East Roswell, one represents Central Roswell, and one represents the West Roswell, and then have three at large city council members, and do that for a 10 to 12 year period, depending on what the council would decide upon, and let those people that are specifically for those particular group areas, they spearhead the movement. Because right now we have a silo of communication within our within how we operate between the city, with everyone being at large and functionally appointed instead of regionally or district type of appointment. And I think you'll see that in 10 to 12 years that each area of Roswell will start improving, and we have to start somewhere with that. And then let's take a look at it after that. But at least then, each area of Roswell will get fair representation.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Lori, same question. What do you bring to the table and what do you want to do?
Well, as I said in my opening remarks, I bring a wealth of background and information and education to the table. I served on Roswell City Council for 8 years. Zoning is what I love, and redevelopment is what I love. I've taught numerous classes on redevelopment throughout the state of Georgia. So I feel like I can hit the ground running from day one. And what we need to do, and the reason why I raise the zoning issue, is because what we need in the city right now is to be proactive. We need someone with a vision. We need someone that can hit the ground running on day one. And that's what I can do for the city. We are at a crossroads. We're at a tipping point. And right now, with the zoning ordinance that we have in place, we are in danger of losing our wonderful community, our historic district, and also the very charming character of Roswell. So, as I'm very fond of saying, we all moved to Roswell for a reason, and high density was not one of those. If you all wanted an urban area, there are wonderful places in the city of Roswell that you can find that would suit you. But the other thing that I want to say when I talk about being proactive, we need to be proactive in bringing businesses in. We need to be proactive in courting corporations that have located in other parts of the city, for example, Mercedes-Benz. They've located in Sandy Springs. But we need to court them. We need to get our real estate agents armed and dangerous with all of our wonderful things we can do here in Roswell. And we need to seek out those executives to have them locate their homes in Roswell. The city of Roswell enjoys our parks and our nature. We've got the live and the play down pat. What we need is the work. And that's why I feel very strongly that we need to bring in the Class A office space into our quarters. Thank you.
Marie, what do you bring to the table?
Well, I'll go back to your Texas analogy and being from Georgia. I'm going to say to me, how many times you can catch more flies with honey than with vinegar. And I think one of the things I bring to the table is the ability to build relationships, to be a good listener, and to work with people and bring and try to bring consensus and to have respect for other people's opinions. And try to work together to some sort of consensus and solution, some sort of vision that we can all agree on. I think that's one of the reasons that I would like to see the community have a lot of input into a revitalization and redevelopment plan for the Holcomb Ridge corridor. With lots of focus groups and design charrettes to just so that everyone can kind of see, bring all the stakeholders together in one room and kind of see what the possibilities are. I'd also like to see maybe that kind of process come to our planning and zoning process when open meetings are held, so that there's an equal balance of education and information and input from the community that comes in. I also think it's very important to build relationships with businesses and to attract them to Roswell, to respect our staff and our consultants, and to respect each other. So I think that those qualities together with leadership and passion and the willingness to do a lot of good work and research are qualities that I would bring to City Council. Thank you.
Shirley.
I have a pair of spurs, just so you know. I'm a horsewoman, and one thing you learn when you're riding a horse is that you take control because it's a big animal. And that's what politics is also, you take control. And that's one of the things I would like to bring is unity to our City Council and have everybody on the same page, may it be the east side or the west side. I have been selling real estate in Roswell for many years, and part of the real estate oath is that we're not supposed to steer people from one side to another. So I have never looked at Roswell as the east side or the west side. I have always thought of it as one, as being a united Roswell, each having its own assets. Now, part of Roswell has deteriorated immensely, which is the corridor going out Holcomb Ridge. And that needs to be refurbished. It needs to be rebuilt. It needs to be re-energized. And I'm also a firm believer that we all need to be thinking about transportation in this city, and transportation is a serious problem. And since there's no more land in Roswell, we're, 75 acres? We gotta do something about transportation because the building is gonna continue to come.
Thank you. Following up with Lori, should the city be actively involved in soliciting reinvestment in Roswell and support new economic development here, or should we be more on guard against new development that brings density to the city of nearly 100,000?
We need to be very proactive, and that is what I'm proposing, to bring in the right type of development, the kind of development that we want. What I believe is happening right now is we are not bringing anyone to us. We are reacting to things that come to us. I think that we have to be very strategic and look for the, number one, we need to lay the base. You know, what can be done? Bring in the experts. Okay, if we want to bring in Class A office space, what do we need in the way of infrastructure? What do we need in as far as density bonuses? What do we need? Where do we go? Who do we talk to court these people and bring them into the city of Roswell? Because that's what we're lacking right now. What we're doing right now is we're reacting to high-density apartments. It just so happens that apartments right now are the hot commodity in the development community. What I would like to see us do, as I was saying before, is seek out what type of commercial development we want to revitalize our corridors. Because if you bring in Class A office, that will bring in daytime visitors that are not a strain on our services. And they also support the existing retail spaces that we have. And that's, right now we cannot sustain our retail. So we need to bring in those daytime visitors. We need to look and consider the transportation issues prior. Also infrastructure, such as cable, you know, the various different things that a tech company might need. What can we attract to our big boxes as far as adaptive reuse? You know, is it a maker's space? What are we looking for? What can we bring in? And how do we seek people out? That's what we need to be doing in Roswell. Right now, we don't have a vision, we don't have a plan, and we're not reaching out.
Marie, what would you do?
Well, in doing a lot of research for tonight and throughout the campaign and looking back through some things that have happened in the past, you know, 15 years, we have had three economic revitalization studies for the Holcomb Bridge Corridor, one in 2003, one in 2007, and another one, the Economic Development Study of 2012. We're still looking at the same problems and trying to solve them. I mean, we were, studies in 2003 said that our retail was overbuilt and greatly exceeded demand. And we're getting ready to do another one. I would like to help lead this economic redevelopment study and make sure that what we find out by bringing stakeholders together from the community, investors, and planning professionals is actually ends up with a plan that we can implement, whatever that may be. But just bringing all the stakeholders together to find out what that plan might be.
Shelley, you're the businesswoman. Tell us what you do.
Well, I think we've got some very educated people sitting out here in the audience tonight that are businessmen that travel the world and do business with people that you're the people that are going to help us keep Roswell alive. And that's what I want to do. I want our city to get more involved. I need businessmen to step forward, business women to step forward and say, I have an idea. Sharing those ideas, having your doors open and your phones on to share with the public ideas, that's where we grow. We don't grow if we don't talk to each other. And you can't expect seven people sitting up here to run the show and not get your input. The only time we get input that I'm hearing and seeing is when it's in your back door and a sign has gone up and then you're worried. We need business, we need development, we need ideas, we need your help. You're the voters, it's your tax dollars. That's it.
Sean, you're up.
Yes, sir. Listen, just like what I believe we've been doing for many years since I've been in Roswell, and I mentioned it at one of the forums on the East Roswell Economic Forum. We've been talking a lot in Roswell. We've been studying. You know, there's some that actually have spent about $1 million worth of studying that never came to fruition back in the early 2000s, and nothing came of it. The studies from 2003 and 2007, nothing came of it. And you got to come to the point of, as a business person, one thing I did leave out is I worked with the $110 million P&L for a region in the International Tower Company. That's 36% more than the general fund for the city of Roswell. And one of the things that we have to do, I believe, is set mechanisms to where we can make talk go to a decision. Right now, we do a lot of talking, we do a lot of studying, and we're spending a lot of the city's money. And when we say city's money, that's you taxpayers, that's your money. And so we keep studying the same things, but we're not setting up a mechanism. And I asked that question at that forum of the panel. At what point can we make a decision to move forward? Because politicians, which I am not, yet, anyway. But politicians need cover to be able to make decisions in most cases, or they're worried about getting voted out. And so in that cover, we've got to figure out a mechanism to where once we get a certain amount of input and agreement, then that project's got to move forward. Otherwise, we spend another $500,000 or whatever it is, or $1 million, whatever we end up spending on all these studies, and we get nothing done. And you know what? I'm pretty upset about that, because that's my taxpayer money too. And at some point, we keep spending that money and doing nothing. We've got to raise property taxes in order to keep paying for those things. So it's time for action. It's time to figure out how do we make those decisions instead of just keep talking.
Thank you. Okay, Green, you're first up now. What should be the city's role in promoting the arts? And what is the city's role in promoting other quality of life features such as festivals and cultural events?
That's a great one. I think that the city should play a very active role in supporting the arts and in giving individuals and organizations an opportunity to support themselves and to make things happen. I've been very involved, as you know, in the Roswell Arts Fund, and we started off 2 years ago with a group of volunteers, and we had a vision to bring the city's first sculpture tour to Roswell. And we started the process. We brought had submissions from 30-something artists. We brought 10 new sculptures to Roswell City Parks, and they were there for 10 months for the city, for visitors to the city to enjoy, as well as the residents. I think there are also lots of other great arts organizations in the city. Georgia Ensemble Theater, ROCA, lots of dance companies, and I think the city's role is to kind of help publicize those, to support them, and to make it possible to create a thriving environment where the arts are welcome and celebrated. I think the city does a great job in sponsoring festivals, February's Roots Festival was a great example of celebrating our culture. We have National Arts and Humanities Month in October. Riverside sales throughout the summer, and I'm 100% think on continuing those kinds of programs that support the arts, because the arts are a great reflection of our culture and our vitality and who we are in Roswell.
Shirley?
I love the arts, and it's one of my personal passions. As far as the city getting involved with it, there's two doors. If we're talking about programs, that's what the chamber is supposed to be doing and developing and bringing in the public. If it's talking about asking the taxpayers to build something to have festivals, or adding more green space or bike trails or whatever has to do with culture and exercise and the arts, that's a case-by-case basis, and it should be spent wisely. And I noticed tonight on TV that Alpharetta has got a huge debate going on. I mean, not a debate, but they're asking the voters, can they build an amphitheater? And I thought, gosh, don't they have an amphitheater already up that way? And they're talking about building another one. So maybe we need to be thinking that way, maybe not. But that's something that can be looked at and studied. Thank you.
Sean.
And a little tidbit of information. I grew up oil painting, actually, and playing classical piano in Arkansas, believe it or not. and I played sports, so. Arts are something that are very important to me. My daughter's involved in them. One of my sons is involved in a lot of things that deal with art. So it is something that's very vital, I think, to the city, to the attraction that people come. The city is very unique and has areas that are unique. My wife and I moved here 11 years ago from Alpharetta after we spent a year there, simply because of the arts, the parks, the schools, the small town feel. So I think it's something we need to do, but what I would like to see is more privatization, bringing it in, such as the Oak Street that's happening, the Oak Street development there. that is a wonderful thing that is happening, and it's a unique thing to Roswell. And we need to find things like that and accentuate those, but do it in a free market type of setting as much as possible so that the taxpayer is not having to foot the bill on most of it. I do believe that the government overall does have a somewhat of a role to play in that, but if we're so reliant upon the government to fund not just the arts, but if the funding is mainly through the government, we've got to relook and try to find ways to bring private investment in for those things. So I love it, and I love the diversity of the arts that we have here, and I will commend Marie and the commission for doing a great job with what they have done, and Marie, I really thank you for that.
Lori.
Thank you. I have a degree in fine arts from Ohio State, so I am an arty person. I've got a daughter that we put through SCAD. She's an arty person. But what I'm looking at with arts in Roswell, there are a lot of ways to support it. The Groveway Master Plan was one of them. Those of you that remember the Groveway Master Plan, it was a village environment with affordable studio / cottage housing where artists could locate within the city of Roswell, where we can foster it from the ground up. So I am very pro that approach. But then also, we always need to keep in mind the city of Roswell is a historic city. We have the wonderful parks programs that have great art programs, and we want to be a destination. And what draws people to Roswell? And I think the arts play a very important role in that. Arts are a little like history. You either have it or you don't, and we've got it. And we need to really promote it through tourism as well as through our programs within the city. Whether you're a child playing at the park, or a child taking a ballet class, or you're an 80-year-old woman taking a pottery class. Our parks programs are awesome, and that's what keep people in Roswell. That's what keeps us living here. So I'm a huge proponent of that, and I'd like to see a lot of ground up, but then tourism promotion. Thank you.
Sure.
Yes, sir.
It has been said much of Roswell's downtown needs reinvigorating and rejuvenation. How active a role should the city play in bringing this about? And if so, should they consult with economic development experts to create a plan of action similar to cities such as Alpharetta, Woodstock, and Duluth?
We're really different than Woodstock. We're really different than Alpharetta. We're very different than Duluth. I think the charm of our city has always been the quaintness and the Mill Valley or Mill type look to the city. And I think we're on track with that because that's what's drawing in the people from different areas. That's what's bringing the income in. And I'm not saying that there aren't larger corporations and companies bringing in, but that's what's putting us back on the map. People are talking about coming to Roswell and going to the historic district and going and having good dinners and sitting outside and enjoying. And to me, I think we're on track there. I think we need to put some money into some things. I'm very excited about the hotel that will possibly be in the back and the underground parking that will be available because a lot of people are questioning where do people park. And I think that's going to be a shining, gleaming boutique place and a hotel or motel. I think it's a hotel, how they have it. But I think that's a plus, and I think that our city is on the right track. But there are other things that need approaching at this time, and I think what has been happened in the downtown area has done just really well so far. Thank you.
Sean, how do you feel about the city's role in rejuvenation?
Well, I think the city, first of all, as a free market kind of guy, I really believe the city needs to look at vetting vendors, or, I'm sorry, developers a little bit better maybe, and seeking out developers from other cities that have worked in small town, historic type downtowns like here in Roswell. And I'm sure we've done that to a certain degree, but then set up the environment for them to work with Roswell Inc. and DDA and come up with ideas to present to the community in the different areas. I think one of the issues that we're having is that we keep looking at everything. When you drive down the street, it looks like we're looking at everything, well, one piece of property by itself. And we need to look at downtown Roswell as a whole, and what do we, how do we want that to look 50 years from now? Because if we don't start looking at that far out, then we're going to keep doing one building at a time or one lot at a time. And then you wonder, in 20 years, we've got this really nice place, and next to it we have a place that's, that maybe we're, for whatever reason, for lack of a better term, we think it's historic because it was built in 1948, but it really needs to be revitalized. And there we have some buildings like that. Really want to redevelop or redefine or figure out, fine-tune what historic really means for us. And then from there, so we can protect those areas, because we do have some historic areas in Roswell that need to be protected. And then outside of that, how do we make that flow together as a whole instead of just looking at each piece of property? And I think there's no one sitting up here who's expert enough to be able to do that. And I think we have to set up an environment as a city and as leadership of the city to where we get the experts and we take some shackles off of them in order to be able to freely come together with some ideas and present multiple ideas. And then we can start approaching landowners and trying to encourage them and find ways to encourage them to do that, or if necessary, in some places, buy the property, which I'm not a huge fan of, but there are times when we need to do that.
All right, your response.
Once again, I believe we need to be proactive. One of the issues that we've got in our downtown is that we've got a very thriving Kent Street, which is wonderful. We all wish we could capitalize on that throughout the entire city. But then just a few blocks down, we've got the historic square that is very much in need of some attention. I was very excited to learn a couple of weeks ago that we've got a new owner of the public house building, that entire corner, with the exception of the CBB. And he is very excited on redeveloping there, bringing in the types of uses we need on the square. We've got great densities on the square as far as housing goes, but what we don't have are what people need to walk to. We've got a pizza parlor, a couple of restaurants, but what we need are the things that the people in that area and also the creative destination are looking for. And I think we need to be very proactive about that. I think we need to be very proactive about the Mimosa Hall. I think, I firmly believe that for a number of reasons, the city really needs to purchase that. Historic properties, in some sense, pay for themselves in that it raises property values, it helps with tourism, it helps to create a destination in the city of Roswell. So I firmly believe that as well. But we do need to really focus on the historic square. We have not been looking at that. I think we are all so happy that we have a success on Canton Street, that the historic square has become the red headed stepchild as opposed to the east side. So, you know, I really feel very strongly that there's a lot we can do in the historic district. However, there is also the hierarchy and the concern and the attention to other areas of Roswell as well, not just the historic or the downtown district, but all of Roswell.
I think Canton Street has become the place where everyone wants to be from all over North Fulton, Atlanta. I've spent several Friday and Saturday evenings talking to folks from, and it seems like there are so many people who are from outside of the city, outside of Roswell. So it's definitely become an attraction, a tourist attraction, as well as just a place that we all love to be and kind of call our own. I think there are three things kind of going on in the historic district that we need to consider kind of come together. One is the historic district. I know there's been a lot of plans and a lot of discussion about our preservation codes and making sure that the districts are correctly aligned and that we have, possibly have different zones for different areas. And I would definitely be in favor of looking at those areas and making sure that what is protected, what we're protecting is worth protecting and that it's being done in the right way. The other aspect to this, to the downtown area, is the need for infrastructure. We need better roads, we need better streetscapes, we need to make some more walkable, safe connections, safer, more attractive gathering spaces for folks, whether that's, you know, at Russell Town Square, which we have, whether that's a, you know, a city green out that nearby here, but just a place to kind of connect and link the walkable areas downtown. The third opportunity that we have is some of the areas, the lighted areas that need redevelopment. There's a project, you know, project that the Downtown Development Authority is looking at with Southern Skillet. I think that they are bringing in investors to take a look at that property and kind of give us some ideas of how that can look. And I think that properly done, that can be just a great shining showcase, actually, for redevelopment and revitalization all over the city, not just in the downtown business district.
Thank you. Okay. Now the pendulum swings back. And we'll begin the next round of questions with Shelley, then we'll go to Marie for the following question, Lori, and back to Sean. So, Shelley.
Yes,
there's been a lot of plans made and a lot of actions taken, but the city center is still just a plan. Where do you stand with building the city center over here, well, actually, behind us? Yeah, behind you, not me.
How do I stand on it? I don't know. I don't know what the budget is. I don't know what the plans are. I don't know what the drawings are. I haven't even been privy to any of that. I've sat in where there's been discussion about it, but to make a decision and stand on it, you got to do some homework. You got to see what it has to cost, and I don't have any of that in front of me because I'm not privy to that at this time. But personally, how I would feel, I would love to see all of this area going all the way down 9 to the river all become a walkable thing. I think that giving from the river all the way up to the beautiful historic district, the square, that whole area needs vitalization. And I agree very much with all three of the people here. That area needs work on it, and it's been overlooked, and I think that we need to see what it's going to cost and then make our decisions, and maybe it has to be in phases, but it's workable. That's it.
Marie, your thoughts?
Once again, in doing some research on some city council conversations, I came across this viewpoint that I agree with 100%. I think that we need to create a catalyst for more opportunity and development down Highway 9. And I think the city green and doing something there will be a step in the right direction. Leaving it is today would be a shame because it's not being utilized to its potential use. And that was my plan early in April last year. I think that the land here is an asset that belongs to the city and it's something that we're utilizing. I think it's an opportunity to link the city campus to the rest of downtown and kind of spark economic development down Alpharetta Highway and bring people closer to our government center. I think that being able to have some connectivity between Camp Street and the government area is a very positive thing, and I think that we may have some solutions for our parking right in our front yard. If you can figure out a way to open up that parking and make it accessible, whether that's, you know, in some safe way to cross over to Camp Street, that could be a way to help alleviate our parking needs without having to build a parking deck spending money on that. I know there's been a lot of talk about the cost for City Green, and as I understand it, the first phase is around, it's just under $7 million, which is a lot more than some of the other costs that I've heard bounced around. I would like to see us take a look at that in consideration with other projects and maybe set priorities. And I would like to see it be looked at and made into a park that is really special and is a destination not only just for the city, but for visitors and tourists, and really kind of helps bring together all the businesses and the community together.
Well, thank you. My fundamental belief on the City Green is that it's misguided. The city has lost its way. It's a very, very expensive project. I am hearing $17 million. It depends on whose projections you're listening to. But if we're going to spend $17 million, I think that there are other areas of Roswell that need it much more than City Hall. City Hall's beautiful. We've got trees, we've got the memorials. I'm not saying that improvements can't be made, but what we have found, and the reason why this project ballooned so much, in my opinion, is because people are not willing to park behind City Hall and walk across to Canton Street and walk down Canton Street to restaurants. I firmly believe that we have an opportunity in various places for public-private partnerships with a parking deck. And that's the way I think that we really need to approach this. I can think of numerous projects that the city can focus money on, and I just don't see it throwing it at City Green as the real option. I'd much rather see the Musk Hall being purchased. I'd much rather see some investment on the east side. And City Hall, I think, is a beautiful campus, beautiful grounds. And I just don't understand why we want to cut down the trees and put up shade block. Thank
you. Sean.
Well, on this issue, I'm slightly torn because I haven't heard anyone really speak very much about the veterans who invested a lot of money I know it was slightly mentioned, but I think my number one concern is the veterans who paid out of their own pocket in many ways. And in talking with them, they feel like that they have a handshake or a gentleman's agreement with the city on not touching the memorial. I do think there's a way to work with it and try to come up with a compromise. I know I saw some of the original plans that had estimates of around $7 million. But I think we need to be very careful regarding moving something like the War Memorial, because it is a registered memorial site. And I think if we do something like that, we've got to work on enhancing that for sure in order to honor our veterans for the sacrifices they made. But I think we have to do something with the World War II Memorial. It's almost, as a veteran and thinking of the greatest generation of our lifetime, and seeing that memorial the way it is, I don't think we can leave it the way it is. And so I'm not quite sure what the answer is. In that I know that we need something here to connect to Canton Street, but I'm not sure that the City Green as it is right now is the viable solution. I would love for it to be. And I don't particularly like cutting all the trees down. I mean, I definitely like hardwoods, pine, struggle with that a little bit because of the pines. I can see us being able to do something with that. But if we could work around the hardwoods and preserve those and compromise some way. And this is where, for me, I think we have to work with the community, because it is a hot button issue with the Vietnam veterans. And we need to work with them more closely and try it again. I know we have in the past, but try it again and reach a compromise with them that will work for both the city and the veterans if possible.
Anne Marie, you're up. We're talking about bringing new business to Roswell. If we do, we're going to have a workforce to serve those businesses. We already hear a lot of legitimate complaints from Canton Street, perhaps our most successful 900 feet of street frontage, that they can't get enough waitstaff and other help for the shops there. So isn't workforce housing a priority for the city to encourage?
Patrick, I think as we start looking at the Economic Development Revitalization Plan, we will have a much better idea on where affordable housing and housing options might fit in. I think that especially along, the Holcomb Bridge corridors and the southwest, the northwest quadrant, if we can come up with a plan that makes that attractive to investors, that perhaps that is a good place to put some more affordable housing. I do think it's a very real concern and very important that Roswell have a variety of different housing types. As our population gets older, I think of some statistic that something like, 35% of Roswell residents, maybe even higher, are going to be retiring in the next 20 years. So we don't want 35% of our people to leave if they choose to downsize. And some of those may be moving to Canton Street, but some of them might be, looking for a smaller option someplace. I do think it's important to have housing that's attractive to younger people and to millennials. Where that is, I think that we will kind of see as we look at these economic development studies. We do have some affordable homes in some neighborhoods that are being rejuvenated by people who come in, by young families and who come in and renovate them, and so that's also providing a good bank of affordable housing. I do think it's important because we have a very mix and a very diverse population, and it's just very important to have a lot of places, housing choices for a lot of different people who choose to live here in Roswell, because that diversity makes us stronger.
Thank you. Lori?
Well, in order for the city to grow and prosper and thrive, we need a mix of all income levels. That's recognizable. We need our beautiful homes that we have here in Roswell. We need to encourage people to continue to redevelop or remodel those. We also have, I've noticed this as I was going door to door, it's amazing to me, how many millennials I'm seeing in houses on cul-de-sacs that they're remodeling them. It's just awesome because you go into a neighborhood, for example, Marcus Lehman, and you see the folks that have been there for 30 years, and then right next door, you see the millennials fixing up those homes because they decided to have children and they wanted to move into a neighborhood setting. And yes, many of them wanted to move into cul-de-sacs. So I think that is a level of housing. Also, workforce housing and low-income housing, as we all know, are very different. There are different thresholds for those. And I think that with our low-income housing, we have got the apartment complexes that we need to stabilize. We need to make them safe so that the folks in Roswell, working in Roswell, feel comfortable living in those apartment complexes. That is key. I don't think we need to build more, because once you stabilize those communities, then grandma is comfortable living there, and hardworking families are comfortable living there as well. So I don't see the answer as building new. I see the answer as looking at our housing stock, what we have, and just promote the city of Roswell as a wonderful place it is to work, live, and play.
Just to follow up, just exactly how do we revitalize the existing stock?
Well, there are a number of programs out there that we can model after, we can look to, and we can ask people to come in. There's a woman that's doing things down in Atlanta, Sandy Springs, and she is doing amazing things. She goes into an apartment complex, she purchases it, and she has a whole business model. It's just a wonderful thing. And then what she does is she price fixes the rent, and she also creates the programs that will help the families to thrive in those environments. And what that does is it creates a safety net the city also needs to be proactive with that as well. And I think that our churches need to be active also with that. Whether or not you bring in or you promote readers, you know, the coaches with your church. And I think that it can be a group effort that that we really need to look at, but we're not looking at those things right now.
Well, first of all, we got to remember that property owners have property rights, and we have to be very careful with what we're telling property owners, what they should and shouldn't do to a certain degree, because that is the foundation of this country and the Constitution of the United States. And one of the many reasons, along with religious freedom, that people came to this country was because of property rights. And it makes us very different in most countries. I've been to 35 countries, and I've lived in a few of them, and I can tell you that the people who are coming to this country, one of the biggest draws is still being able to own their own property. And so, and the reason I say that is because these apartments that Lori talks about, it's very difficult to tell a landowner who has a cash cow that they need to do something with it, or bring in a developer and tell them that here are recommendations. I mean, at some point you either got to incentivize that, which the government, I think we need to be careful about that, because that puts us on the hook. The other option is, you know, we buy it out, bulldoze it, and rebuild, and that's a very expensive proposition that the city's not, I've heard the meetings, they're not ready for that. The city's not ready to do that yet. So I think we can try to incentivize to a certain degree some of the owners who own these properties, but I think with new development, we do have to find some limited areas where we can fit that model and do that model, where we can maybe work with the developer and the landlord to do certain codes to where there's a certain amount of worker workforce housing. My son, who's about to come back from Afghanistan, is looking to be a police officer in the area. And frankly, he and his wife would probably have a hard time affording something. And I know many of our police officers and teachers cannot afford to live here. And I think we do need to find market solutions and working with developers to do that, and be careful with property owners.
And now I believe we're at the Lori's turn to go first. And some years ago, there was an internationally known community planner who was working in Roswell, and he had an idea to take everything on this side of the street from the courthouse to Sloan Street and have a sort of urban renewal that would turn it into a Canton Street-like atmosphere with small shops and streets. It's an area that's tailor-made for that sort of thing. The topo is favorable to it. He actually envisioned one street with a big pedestrian, because there's some natural little plateaus where you could have alfresco dining and looking at the vista below you on a couple of different levels. But something like that to shoot for, would that be something that the city might approach the existing owners to create something proactively that would be as successful, if not more so, than Canton?
Well, I think that's a wonderful opportunity that we should always pursue. I think we need to look at the tools where we can incentivize property owners to bring their properties together, because as was said earlier, it can't be done piece by piece. And what you have to look at is how you can bring property owners together to their benefit. In Roswell, we have a number of property owners that just really enjoy having their monthly income. They're sitting on properties. I just spoke with a gentleman the other day. He's sitting on his property. There's not a lot of incentive for him to redevelop because he is making money on that property, and that's his retirement income. And I was talking to him, and I said, you know, there are programs and there are models in other places that we don't have to invent the wheel. But what you can do is bring property owners together, come up with a project with their collective properties that's much larger, and then they can, their individual property is put into the collective, and then they receive a percentage of income once it's redeveloped and they bring in businesses. So it turns a single property owner into numerous property owners, where you can get people amassing property in order to take on something like that. I think we should look at those kinds of things, and I think we should also talk with those property owners and have a conversation with them, because right now we're not, and right now we're just waiting for them to come in individually and redevelop their property with not a lot of incentives. So and I think we need to look at the big picture.
I would just say that the beauty of that project was there's, I think, two, perhaps three property owners who own the whole area, so you don't have that many people to convince.
Right.
Well, again, the government, we have very limited ways that we can do this. I mean, we can incentivize them by reducing the fees that they pay, or we can reduce somehow, give them forgiveness on property, or occupancy tax. But occupancy tax is not going to be enough of an incentive to do that. So I think this is where we got to develop ways for these developers to go to the DDA, to Roswell Inc., and work with them. That's what they're there for. They're the experts of coming up with funding for these things, making sure that there's accountability and transparency in those departments relative to whatever funding that we will provide as a city. But free market like that usually comes up with a much better solution than what a government, people from the government are going to come up with. And they're a lot more efficient with it. Because then you've got to also talk to them about infrastructure that's going to have to be in place. I mean, we have to work on our infrastructure here in Roswell, and we can't look at infrastructure separately, in my opinion, than whatever we're building that's new or redevelopment, because there are a lot of areas where our pipes are not where they need to be. There's septic areas where we need to look at sewer. And so those are infrastructure improvements that we have to make. And when you start doing those things, you can't do them in a vacuum as if we have unlimited funding. And so we have to begin to find ways to get people to partner and come up with those plans through the Roswell Inc. and DDA. And then if we do need to provide a incentive of some type, I think it has to be vetted, because in the business world, one of the things I've tried to, as a regional sales manager, one of the things that I would not approve is to incentivize something that could not stand alone, or a project wasn't good enough to make it on its own. Because if you pull the incentive at some point, or we get into a financial crisis and we have to stop incentivizing, then we've set this project up to fail. So we have to be careful with that and use the experts that we have appropriately.
Shelley, your ideas?
I'm going to answer a little bit also on affordable housing. On affordable housing, I think that Roswell is desperately in need of it. And I think people, when they hear that, they become fearful of it. But it's government funding a small minority of units in a large complex with normal people paying normal rent. So there's areas in Roswell that I believe, if they were approached properly, they could become partners with affordable housing, and the housing that exists could be taken down and something beautiful could be built and be more acceptable to the surrounding of Roswell. As for this back here in the terrace level, I would love...
Hold on, did I leave you out of the...
That's all right, I just answered.
Yes, you did.
Okay, let's give her another 2 minutes.
Okay. But as far as the project in the back here, with three owners having that all put together, I think if somebody approached them privately, it could be a phenomenal development. And our place at city council and sitting here is not to put it together, it's to let the private industry put it together and for us to use common sense in what's going to be built there and the density, and a village could be created, and it could be a walking park from here to City Hall to Canton Street, down to the river, to the, you know, it could be tied together beautifully. And I think we really need to think about that in the long-term run. And we need to go out to the private public and say, hey, this is here for offering, come and look at it. Thank you.
Thank you. Now, Rashawn, what ideas do you have for reinvigorating Roswell? Or does Roswell really need reinvigorating?
Well, I think, at least to the eyes, I would say yes. I think there are areas, as all of us have mentioned, need to be revitalized. I think we're all in agreement that there are areas that need to be redeveloped. So there are many corridors, and this is where I like to look at the city and its uniqueness in the different areas of the city and see what is unique, see what needs to be, like Oak Street, Oak Street development, I mentioned that earlier with the artist area. We need to accentuate that. We need to look at areas like Southern Skillet and make sure that we're working on revitalizing that. But we need a lot of private input with those things and how to handle that. But we also need to be getting to the community and asking them what they need and what they would like to see on the front end. And I think this is where we've got to take the government back to the people. And one of the things that I would like to do is at least every month, once or twice a month, going out to different areas of Roswell and talking to the community and asking them, whether it's business owners in that area or homeowners in those particular areas, and asking them, what is it that you would like to see? And kind of doing that informally, but this goes back to the plan I was talking about when we have three people that specifically represent each area of Roswell, so that that person can be that and be that liaison between that part of the community and bringing those plans and working with the right entities, the experts, along with the people who live there and work there, to come up with good ideas to revitalize those areas. There's such a uniqueness to Roswell that we need, and each area has a unique area. And we need those destination spots to be revitalized in different areas. So yeah, there are so many things that we could do to redevelop areas of Roswell that's falling down. There's some areas that are truly eyesores that we need to find ways to work with developers or work with the property owners to free up and do something with it. And so the question you asked was really more of a yes or no. Yes, we do need to revitalize. And I think our future is dependent upon that.
Shelley, your response to that?
Well, I think we need to work on everything that we've been talking about here, but I also think that we need to work on the other side of Roswell, because we've got a lot of brown space over there, major commercial areas that are sitting vacant, and you know, losing big boxes and making statements that, you know, Roswell doesn't support them, that's why they're closing after 20 months, is a hard bite. And when you start losing business like that and they go elsewhere, you have to take a deep look at yourself as a city and say, what's going on? Is it more important to support our next door neighbors and our people right here in the city? Or do we drive up the road and support Alpharetta or Sandy Springs or Woodstock? And we're right in the middle. And right now we've got one thing going where Canton Street is chic and new, but we've got to think about what's going on the other side also and revitalize that. And I think that's a large challenge. And I think that it needs help. We need to balance it. We need to be unified all the way across. Thank you.
Earlier this month, we had two packed houses, almost like this one, over in Eddie's Russell Park to talk about revitalizing and redevelopment in East Roswell. And I think there's definitely a huge interest in revitalizing that area. During those two meetings, we heard a lot of great ideas and a lot of needs kind of voiced from the community. You know, some of the things mentioned, you know, anything from, you know, a maker space to an auditorium to a food court to a live, work, play to, you know, shopping retail destination. One of the things that we also kind of learned that came out of that is that there are certain things that need to happen in order for that revitalization to happen. And that means that a couple of things need to come together. First of all, any development has to be economically viable and attract the right kind of investor. It has to be sustainable long-term so that whatever goes in is something that lasts for a lifetime, that we're getting buildings that are really high quality and that there's a market for whatever comes in and a use that the community will support. And then also one of the most important aspects is what will the community allow and what would the community like to see within the parameters of making sure that we get the right investors and it makes sense within a big community plan. So as far as the answer to your question, I think we really need to look long and hard about bringing all those groups together and coming together with a plan to revitalize and then actually, you know, sticking to it. Let's ask investors what they need, what they'd like to see to come into our community, and kind of ask, you know, how can we support you through whatever incentive programs or community improvement districts or development authorities. But it's something that we need to realize that we can't do it ourselves. The government, can't do it, but it's something that we kind of need to look to the business community and ourselves to make revitalization happen.
Well, again, I'll say to grow and prosper and thrive, a city has to reinvest in itself on a daily basis. Whether it's through our parks programs, whether it's through economic development, whether it's, no matter what it is, redevelopment, the city needs to reinvest in itself. Because what we basically want to do, and it's a balancing act, money is not limited, and trust me, when we're talking about spending your tax dollars, we need to act very frugally. But you know, what is it that our daily needs that the city has? And I think we need to balance those very carefully, because I think in the past, what we've done is kind of just locked onto one item, and you're not thinking about the other issues. We need to reinvest in our parks, in our commercial corridors, in our historic district. We need to do all of those in order to make Roswell a great place to live and that we want to stay in. Thank you.
John Reed, you can begin, Professor.
Yes, sir.
Okay, now we'll go to the audience. This question will be in some ways very similar, because I noticed when I asked that question about redevelopment in the city, everybody sort of actually gravitated to talking about East Roswell. And that's my next question. East Roswell feels like they're sort of the redheaded stepchild of Roswell, and don't get the attention that this side of 400 gets. And they're scared. I saw town hall meetings there, I think many of you were probably there, and they're worried about Target leaving. They're worried about Kohl's leaving. One man read a letter that he got from Kroger that said, would you shop at this Kroger up the street if this one wasn't available? Well, that's sort of the handwriting on the wall. They're trying to gauge should they get out. So how do we stop the bleeding in East Roswell that area? And how do we revitalize that area in particular?
Well, I think that is very important, and I do feel that people are justified for feeling like a redheaded stepchild. for many years in the beginning, not the beginning of Roswell, but the beginning of the east side. Before it was annexed in, it was part of Fulton County, and Fulton County dumped on East Roswell. Then East Roswell comes into the city, and, you know, this, some people don't see East Roswell as part of Roswell. They see it as a section on the other side of 400. So, again, what I'm saying is we need to be proactive. I think we need to bring in office space, Class A office into the corridor. That would help sustain the retail that cannot be sustained right now. It also helps give us the third equation into live, work, and play, if we can get office in. The other thing that's very popular and does well in Roswell is the condominium style office. We need to look at that. We need to look at incentivizing with density types of offices, and we need to go out to businesses too, because we're not doing that. We did something right years ago when we brought in Kimberly Park and GM and a couple of the others. But what are we doing now? And how can we attract those businesses to Roswell? Because right now, they're leapfrogging us. They're either stopping at Sandy Springs or they're going on to Alpharetta. And I think that a lot of it has to do with a proactive approach and telling people what we want, what we need, and what we can do to help you get it, because we need those daytime visitors in East Roswell.
Well, I live in East Roswell, and I just would first of all like to say, don't count us out yet. I would say that someone who you know has lived there since 1993, you know, there may be a few empty boxes that have left recently, and I think that Target just really crushed us all, because that's something that really became a daily habit for many of us. I think the city has invested in some improvements in Roswell, East Roswell Park, which is a great park. We have a library, we have wonderful schools, we have George Landing, we've got Complete Street on East Road. We have some new homes coming in, you know, at Allstead. There are a couple of other, you know, small businesses that have been popping up. You know, and I'd like to think that this is just kind of a change in the way these buildings and the way these spaces are used. We have, you know, after coming together as a community last week, or in the past month, I think we kind of realized that we need to think about how to work together and how to bring investors into the community and to revitalize. We've heard that people want a gathering space, they want a community place together, just like Canton Street, and I'm really looking forward through this revitalization study that we'll be able to bring the community investors and planning professionals together and try to figure out how we can get over this bump in the road and continue to make East Roswell a great place to become and a great place to live. And I would also encourage you all, it's really not that far. It's 15 minutes. It's about 20 minutes to City Hall, and it's in about 20 minutes over there. And there are some great destinations to get to and some great people. And I think as long as we all just try to stay involved and engaged in our civic affairs, then we're all, that's how we become one last ball.
Thank you.
Well, I think we've got some phenomenal neighborhoods over there, and I think we've got great values. The property values on that side of Roswell are phenomenal, and you all that live over there know that. And I think what we need to do is, there's only a small group or an area that is really affecting, and that is really from 400 to the river. And I think that, you know, it's not branching off deep into the neighborhoods, because the neighborhoods are taken care of by the parks and having and also you, wonderful thing is you've got a tremendous amount of parks over there. But going back to the train of thought, the that area, my vision and Kimberly Clark's vision when they came here in the early 70s was to have an area where people could come and work and live close by. And that's how those neighborhoods were developed, and a lot of the people that bought there came working with Kimberly Clark, and that's how they developed. And I think that what we have to do now is take that road and revitalize it. And I think that going back to both of our mayors that we've had people with sight, but then we've also had people on the other side that would say, no, we don't want this, we're worried about traffic. Traffic studies will continue to grow. One of the things that I want to see happen is possibly bringing rapid transit up. I think it would bring more business. I would like to see those shopping centers come down and new shopping centers come up. We don't, I'm sorry.
Mr. Hurt, may I answer that question, please?
Oh, I'm sorry. Don't hesitate to let me cut you off, because
I just didn't want that Texas Arkansas robbery to get in the way.
Well, we always win most of the time anyway.
I knew that was coming. But we did win the national championship yesterday. All right, for all of you redheads in here, I want to apologize because we've really defamed you tonight. So I apologize for that, especially my wife. But first, I think we're in the middle of doing community input that I think is very vital for that area, for East Roswell. And I would implore you that if you live in East Roswell, to take part in that survey. Now, my concern with that survey is this, is that we're asking for the input of what you want to see, but I'm wondering is what are the goals that we're trying to achieve? Because, I mean, are we trying to just put something up that's government related that we're funding, or are we trying to bring in small business? So I think it's very critical for the residents in that area to specifically put things in that survey that they expect, whether it's a Class A office space, whether it's small to medium businesses, because that leads us into another situation that's for all of Roswell, and that is we depend quite a bit on personal property tax. And we need to increase our business occupancy tax as much as at least 4 or 5% in the city. And it may be an opportunity to do that in this area, but we need the residents to really step up and tell, say on those surveys, because there have been a couple of things that have been presented, and several hundreds of thousands of dollars have been spent. And then when it's come to the community, it's been rejected because we didn't, it's almost as if we didn't check with the community first. And so it's very important that this feedback comes from the community, because at the end of the day, the community will decide what Roswell does, period. I mean, we represent you, and that's the way the government should be. We represent the people of the city. And so it's imperative that you do that. But I do believe that we need to look at small business revitalization out there and finding the types of businesses that would take over the things that are empty. And because I have less, not very much time, I won't be able to expand on that, but feel free to call me about it. But I think it's important that we do something with business, on the business side there, along and have the input from the residents.
Lord. Oh, I'm sorry.
I messed him up with winning the national championship.
You did. We're looking at the situation in East Roswell, where they feel disconnected from Roswell, and their fears of watching development lead their. What specifically for that side of town, we need to reach out to them, do you think?
I apologize, Kendra. I thought I just answered that question.
Did you start that? Okay. Yes. Where are we then? Because I was so entrenched in that answer.
Okay.
Okay.
So I
think we all answered that.
We all answered. Okay, good. So that means I was sharing that, right? If you're elected to this council, I think we'll call it somewhat dysfunctional in the way that there seems to be a clique and a lot of mistrust among the council members of one another and of others. How would you deal coming into that kind of situation?
Well, I come in first with the feeling that they trusted me and I trusted them. And I worked for unity and I would work very hard to, you know, debate is always good as long as you all come to a good conclusion and it has to be for our voters and not what we personally have as an agenda. And so I think I'm the person that can bring and unite everyone together and we can make great decisions and move on quickly, make decisions, pass things, build things, make our Roswell greater, stronger. So everybody goes, gosh, I like our mayor, I like our council, everything's rocky and rolling well.
John?
Yes, sir. With my experience in the business world, where I've worked with 50 different nationalities and multiple ethnicities, and I've worked with people from different religious backgrounds, many from no religious background. And what I've found, there's a common thread in all of that, is that you've got to first try to, it sounds very corny, but you've got to seek to understand before you're being understood. That's one of Stephen Covey's Seven Habits of Highly Effective People. And I think that once you do that, you start establishing a relationship so that you can find common ground. It's also something I did when I was in sales. I always tried to find common ground with those people I was working with or with customers. Because at the end of the day, people don't care so much about what you know until they know what's in your heart. And if you, and you know, then they start thinking about would they work with you. And if people size you up as they're not going to work with you from the beginning, you can't find common ground, all you're going to do is argue. And you're not going to come to an agreement. It's very difficult in relationships. And so there are times when you got to give and take a little bit. And I think what I would do is, because of that experience, I've learned how to be a bridge. Even when I've got a very strong personality, and I've learned though that how to be that bridge and be strong with seeking at least some common ground to where we can build consensus. And I think that is something that I could help bring. I've met with every one of the council members except for one. I'm meeting with them tomorrow and the mayor, and I've met with many community leaders for that purpose, is try to find out where is common ground that we can work from, because I think that goes back to East Roswell too, is that sometimes you gotta find enough common ground to get some small successes just to change the environment and change people's psyche. And then you can go and build from that. It's something I try to do with baseball, I try to do it with business, I try to do it with the nonprofit I work with, because I work with people from the Middle East who believe very differently than I do. And you've got to be able to find a way to respect people and find that common ground before you can do anything else.
Well, I'd like to say debate and conversation is part of the democratic process. If we don't have that, we don't have a democracy. I think that the important thing for everyone, though, is to respect each other's opinion, respect their truth, and they should respect your truth. And, you know, when you look at it from just the standpoint, I've been married 30 years. I love my husband dearly, but he and I debate. We don't always agree, and sometimes they're very passionate debates, but I still appreciate his opinion. I appreciate what he has to say from the standpoint that he's looking at something, because we all come to the table with a different perspective. And I think that that's always very important to respect perspectives, respect people's opinions on things, and try to find the consensus in it all. And I think that that is just what's very important in the entire democratic process.
Okay. Maria, your thoughts?
Well, I think one of the first things might be to do some sort of fun icebreaker activity, like one of those groups where people go to now as entertainment, and you spend an hour trying to figure out how to get out the door, and you can't do it without teamwork and without working together and actually having fun and laughing together. I think what's very important in any team and bringing together is, again, the key word of respect, to respect each other's perspectives and backgrounds and what their goals are. And just kind of understand where they're coming from and maybe even what it is that they're trying to accomplish. I think that we need to encourage an environment where people are willing to compromise and to listen. And I think ultimately, at the end of the day, I kind of realize that we're all here for the same purpose, and that is to make Roswell the very best city that it possibly can be. I think there are plans that have been put into place with council and community planning input, that if we can kind of look at all of the objectives and projects that we're doing and kind of work towards, you know, whether they do or do not meet that plan. There's also a huge fiscal responsibility. It seems like we're always talking about a lot of projects that cost a lot of money, but I think we need to prioritize and see which one of those projects really can fit the long-term goals of the city. But again, I think it's just kind of learning to work together, learning to listen to each other, learning to find compromises, and just kind of learning that we're all here representing almost 100,000 people in the 7th largest city in the state, and that's what we're here to do, not to fight for or to argue about, you know, specific you know, issues that might have brought us to the table.
Thank you.
Yes.
Have you answered that question? Okay, good. So, mercifully, we're coming to the last part of the session. The engineer will start with you, Shelley.
Yes.
Have 2 minutes for conclusion.
My conclusion. I think that we have a phenomenal city here, and we have wonderful people that are here tonight wanting us at the city level to be balanced and make good decisions for them. We need your input, and I've got one small quote that I think has to do with everything that we do in life, and the quote is, "Trust does not come with a refill. Once it is gone, we probably will never get it back. So what I'm asking you is to trust me. I will do my due diligence, and I would love for you to vote for me. Thank you."
Thank you. Marie?
I'd just like to thank you all for coming tonight. I know it's been a long evening, but I appreciate you coming to take the time to learn about all the candidates that are running for this good seat. If I'm elected throughout my campaign, I have 3 promises, many more actually, but 3 main platforms. And one is to keep the identity zoning out of their neighborhoods and also to believe in their neighborhoods. We've gone through the process in the past year of reworking the zoning codes to protect the neighborhoods, and we've heard loud and clear that keeping our neighborhoods intact is very important to all of our residents. I also believe in protecting in our neighborhoods and investing in our neighborhoods as far as supporting our police and fire to ensure safety, supporting our schools where we need schools throughout the community, and looking for ways to improve walkability, connectivity, and just finding a way to create a sense of community in Roswell that embraces everyone and all who we are. Second is to improve the Hope of Ridge Corridor. We talked a lot about the need for revitalization and coming together with a vision that's achievable and sustainable. Third is something we really haven't talked a lot about, but it's just preserving and protecting our history and also our natural assets, our historic districts, our preservation guidelines, our historic homes. you know, as well as the river, which I think the river is such a wonderful asset for the city, and the plans in place to help make that even more of a crown jewel for the city of Roswell. So my vision for Roswell is what we believe in our neighborhoods, preserves our resources and history, but I'd also like to see us create a future that's bold and vibrant, and make sure that if we're around for, you know, another 200 years as a wonderful place to call home. So thank you for your vote and for your service.
Thank you. Laura.
Thank you, Hunter, and thank you all for coming this evening. I really appreciate it. It's just great to see you all out supporting local elections, because it's fairly uncommon. It'll be a very low voter turnout. There are a couple things I'd like to leave you with. One of them is that I see a threat to our existing neighborhoods because of the high density zoning that is allowed or was allowed in the UDC, and it could return quickly. I feel like the city of Roswell could turn their back on the residences of Roswell. The residences of Roswell have voiced loud and clear numerous times about how they feel about high density coming into the neighborhoods. So I really think we need to stay on top of that. And when we talk about that as well, I would like to let you all know that at Laura Henry Now Facebook page, starting tomorrow, we're going to start a fact check section. So many of the things you may have heard tonight or in canvassing or wherever the case may be, please fact check them. The other thing too that I'd like to leave you with is the east side of Roswell really needs a sense of place and a destination. And what I'd like to do is propose that we buy the property known as Seven Branches. It used to be the Shirley property. I think we can create a wonderful destination spot there if we do it correctly. And we have a wonderful, fabulous entrance into the park, and we can build around that. And that's another example of what I'm talking to you about reinvesting in Roswell. We've got a rich history. We've got rich natural resources, and we have very articulate, intelligent people that we need to listen to. So I ask you to vote for me, Lori Henry. But early voting has already started, the general election on the 21st. Thank you all again for coming.
Sean.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, Mr. Hurd, for moderating this, and thank all of you for coming and being a part of this. And I'd like to thank all of you up here on the platform for a wonderful night. And thank you for hearing our vision for Roswell. And I want to bring up one point with my son. I've shared this campaign with him, and we've spent a lot of quality time together. He's 16-year-old Roswell High School student, hopefully representing Georgia or the Governor's Honors Program here soon. But one of the favorite parts of the campaign has been our late night stops on Saturday night, because, you know, with all the traffic, you can't put signs out during the day without almost being run over. So we've been making Saturday night stops at IHOP and Waffle Houses. And here's something he said that's been motivating me. And here's, and I quote, "These are the qualifications of a city council member: compassion, leadership, and a servant heart. All of the other details will work themselves out, because when you care about the people, the city, and their quality of life, there's not much wrong you can do." What that means is service before self. It means leadership that will be honorable, but again, it will be service before self, and it will be someone who will work to truly unite the city. And that is something I will commit to for you, work for you, just like I have been out, and my son has been out canvassing over almost 4,000 houses by foot. We will work that hard for you in Roswell. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to take a point of personal privilege. I'm going to ask these ladies and one gentleman to stand, please. Thank you all.
turn out, we got some good candidates.
Now, where's your twin? Hey, hey, how are y'all? Claudia Wood.
How are you?
I'm not as far as you.
Thank you very much.
How are you?
Thank you.